Okay. All right. While we're waiting, as soon as our senators get here, we'll go ahead and start the meeting. But while we're waiting, would the proponents please come up and take their seats at the desk here? And we will open the meeting. Let me read, first of all, that Senator Sam McCann is not able to be with us today. He sends a letter pursuant to the motion adopted to create the subcommittee. I hereby appoint Senator Bill Brady to temporarily replace Senator Sam McCann as member of the Senate Agriculture and Conservation Subcommittee on Food Labeling. The appointment is effective immediately and will automatically expire upon the adjournment of the committee meeting. And Senator Brady had to step out for a few minutes, but he will be back. Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Senator Brady?
He is here.
Senator Holmes?
Here.
Senator Frericks?
Present.
Senator Kaler?
Here. And welcome to everyone. Let me just mention that we have some requests for media, Chicago Independent Media, the Media Speaks, and WAIT Radio, WJYS-TV. I have asked for permission to record or photo the proceedings, and permission is granted, seeing no objection. Just a reminder that if anybody wants to take any kind of video or stills, you can do so, but you have to have permission from the chair so that we can record your name and who you are. Also, this is a committee hearing, a subcommittee hearing. It's not a public hearing, and we've had a little bit of clarification we've needed to do in the past couple of hearings. What we've invited is a panel of proponents and a panel of opponents to hopefully enlighten all of us as to their perspective on this issue, and that's how we're going to proceed, is with the proponents at first. Let me also ask committee members if you have any opening comments or remarks. With that, I will ask the proponents to proceed, and if you would, all of you individually introduce yourselves, and then whatever order you've picked to go first, you can proceed with that. So if you would just start by introducing yourselves.
Hi, my name is Michael Hansen. I'm a senior scientist at Consumer Reports. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Patty Lavera. I'm the assistant director of Food and Water Watch.
My name is William Kling. I'm a professor and policy consultant.
Ann Reisner. I'm a professor in agricultural and environmental communications at U of I.
Let me just state that we've given each panel an hour. You can use that hour however you want. We do have to be out of this room by 1 o'clock because there's another committee meeting here. So I've got just about 20 minutes before 11. So we'll be fair to each panel, but go ahead and proceed.
Hi, again, I'm Ann Reisner. I want to thank you for the opportunity to let me speak. I am not only a professor of communications, but I'm also on a farm in very, very northern Wisconsin, and I've been concerned with talking and reading and researching this issue for a lot of years. And in thinking about how to start talking about this issue, the first thing I wanted to look at and talk about was, do labels work? I mean, if they don't work, it doesn't make any difference. And as a matter of fact, if we look at what people do when they're near food and are picking up the boxes of food, they do, in fact, read the labels. Not all of them, not all the time, but at least 60% of people interviewed in study after study after study say they read the labels some of the time, at least until they know that product. Okay, so the second thing is, if they read them, does that make a difference? One of the things that we're finding out from a variety of studies is that, in fact, it does make a difference. If people read the label, if they understand the label, if they feel competent and able to make the food changes, that we're finding out that people that are in those groups that kind of say, yes, we can, are healthier. They tend to weigh less. They tend to have better blood chemistry panels, and all in all, we think that labels are an effective tool. They're not everything you need, but they are a part of people making healthy food decisions. Second thing, do people want this? And the major respectable public opinion polls, and I'm talking ABC, I'm talking NBC, I'm talking the New York Times, are saying that high, large numbers of people want the labels. And it is, at some cases, we're talking 90% of the population, or the respondents interviewed, want these labels. And that's virtually an unheard of consensus among people. So yeah, in fact, people do want the labels. And the third point I want to make is that when we eat things, no matter what things we eat, we're testing them inside our bodies. And it is good when we take these things in and test them in our bodies that we're able to then use the information on what effects that food has to help children and to help the future, to help people coming down the line. One of the nice things about labeling is if we have the labels and people know when they're labeling, years from now, 20 years, 30 years, 50 years from now, scientists are going to be able to compare people who read the labels with people who didn't read the labels, and they're going to be able to tell if a food that slipped through that we now think is perfectly fine is in fact related to some things we haven't thought about now. So with those labels, we get that extra added security of being able to catch things when they slip through the process. For all these reasons, labels work, people want them, and we might just be able to detect something we don't really know now that we ought to have detected in the future. I want to say that these are entirely my own opinions, and I'm not speaking as an official university representative, but I do think that this is a pretty good idea. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Senator, Mr. Chair, Senator Holmes, Senator Frerichs, and if Senator Brady comes in. My name is William Kling, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today at this subject matter hearing to testify in support of Senate Bill 1666 concerning labeling of genetically engineered food. As an attorney and policy expert for almost 30 years, I have focused my work on improving the lives of children, youth, and family, and the communities in which they live. One of the many hats I wear is as an adjunct professor of law at IIT Chicago Kent College of Law, where I teach law students how to engage in the policy process, and I have some law students here today observing this hearing. Several years ago, senators, I worked on the creation of the Illinois Food Systems
Let me just interrupt you a second. We have another media request, Illinois Right to Know, NBC Chicago, and I'll grant them permission. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you. Several years ago, I worked on the creation of the Illinois Food Systems Policy Council legislation at the state level here, and also worked at the federal level on the last farm bill in that cycle. We worked on the Healthy Urban Food Enterprise Development Center. So I've done quite a bit of work on food policy related issues. This year, I'm struck by the number of new members of the General Assembly, particularly on the House side, and I know that with new members comes new priorities and issues. And I believe that the regulation of genetically engineered food is a relatively new issue facing state legislatures. As such, I really appreciate your approach to developing sound public policy by engaging in the series of subject matter hearings that this is one of, to garner as much knowledge as you can as possible on this important issue. So great approach on that. As a professor at the University of Illinois Chicago School of Public Health, I'm particularly interested in the public health issues surrounding food and food systems. One issue I believe warrants a full policy strategy is how to regulate the production and labeling of genetically engineered food. While much of what you've heard over the past several months relating to the research around genetically engineered food is truly not yet settled, I submit that the fundamental issue before you today relates to consumers having necessary information to make informed and educated decisions about the food that they eat, and you heard from my colleague on some of that earlier. This proactive policy approach is sound because genetically engineered food is a relatively new technology with potential significant health risks. The precautionary principle is not a revolutionary idea. The European Union operates under what's called the precautionary principle, assessing each food safety before approving its commercialization. Over 60 countries have given consumers the right to know about genetically engineered food by passing mandatory labeling regulations, including all European Union member states, Australia, Brazil, China, Japan, Korea, New Zealand, Russia, and Saudi Arabia. At its crux, Senator, Senate Bill 1666 is a consumer protection bill, and without question, giving consumers more information about the food they eat is good public policy. In my experience, good public policy is proactive, as I said, and adequately responds to both interest-based and constituency-based needs. In this case, it's clear that constituents are in favor of labeling genetically engineered food. And you heard from my colleague, but I'll just reiterate a couple things. While a relatively new issue on the policy scene, polls going back over 10 years demonstrate consumers' desire to be informed about the food that they eat. An ABC News poll, as she mentioned, conducted in 2001, found that 93% of Americans believe the federal government should require manufacturers to label genetically engineered foods. In 2008, the New York Times poll, she mentioned, found that 87% of American consumers wanted GE ingredients labeled. That's a mandate. And then in 2012, more recently, 91% of voters polled in a Melman Group study called on the FDA to require labels on genetically engineered foods or goods containing genetically engineered ingredients. Clearly, at the state level, within your jurisdictional rights and priorities, Senate Bill 66 responds to this consumer-driven issue. As a public health practitioner, I believe it is in all of our interests, consumers, producers, and policymakers, to regulate the labeling of our food to include information on whether the product is genetically engineered. Requiring labeling is an appropriate role for government to take to give consumers the information they need to make, and we all need, to make rational decisions. It is a sensible addition to require, in the ways that we require nutrition, ingredients, and country of origin information on labels to include the genetically engineered information. It allows us to make better informed decisions about the food that we eat. In summary, I would strongly urge you to consider passage of Senate Bill 1666 relating to labeling of genetically engineered food. The bill, as drafted, Senator, represents a reasonable and rational approach to addressing this important consumer protection issue. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, and I officially want to welcome Senator Brady to the subcommittee. Is there any questions by any members of the committee? Senator Holmes.
Good morning, Senator.
Turn your microphone on.
Oh, sorry. Thanks, Mike. Based on your testimony, I want to just go over. The bill doesn't say we have to label with any of the specific ingredients used
right.
to genetically. So all we're doing is doing a broad-based label that says it's been genetically modified. In this bill, we don't label meat, milk, eggs, cheese, anything that comes from an animal that's been fed genetically modified foods. I mean, let's face it, we have a lot of corn-fed beef. So I'm assuming now we're okay eating that meat even though the animal that we're consuming has been fed genetically engineered foods. So is that still going to present a problem?
Well, I'm not a subject matter expert on the medical, and I know we have other panelists that can address that issue. What I would say from the policy perspective is that, as we know, policymaking is incremental, and I think we have to take one step at a time. And I think my other panelists will be able to answer the more technical question you asked. But on the policy side, I think this is the right approach for the time.
Okay, and I understand what you're saying. My other question, though, is trying to look at this from a practical and reasonable standpoint, how do we do this on a state-by-state basis? We take in a lot of products here that are grown in other states. So well, how would we know if those are genetically modified, or are we just not going to have access to those foods? I think that's where I'm having a problem, because no other state has actually managed to do this. And I agree with you, and you brought it up yourself, is that this needs to be done on a federal level. I mean, we need to do it nationwide in order to be able to do it. I don't see how we piecemeal it state by state.
Well, I do think it is a reasonable approach to look at both the federal element of this and a state element. There's many policies that have both federal components and state components, and I think that it is reasonable and rational for the state legislature to regulate within its purview, within its regulatory powers that it has through the legislative process and the regulatory process through our Department of Agriculture. So I think it is reasonable to look at
this. I would just like to know how much food we're going to and how much product we're not going to be able to then have come into Illinois if this is what we're doing in Illinois and no other state is doing it. And I just don't see how we do it on a practical level.
And on the more technical question on that, I will defer to my panelists who you'll hear from in a minute, and I know they'll have some answers to
your
questions.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions by the committee? Let me just mention, too, that we do have a number of witness slips, and we have some witness slips as well that have been filed electronically. Those will all be made part of the record, so anybody in the audience or listening can weigh in on this via electronic or written witness slips. So who is next?
Hi. Good morning. My name is Patty Lavera. I'm the Assistant Director of Food and Water Watch, a nonprofit consumer advocacy organization. I'm based in D.C., but we also have an office here in Chicago. So I appreciate the opportunity to testify before your subcommittee in strong support of SB 1666. The first genetically engineered crops became commercially available in the U.S. in 1996. Today, the major commercially available GE crops include alfalfa, canola, corn, cotton, papaya, soy, some squash, sugar beet, and some sweet corn. And more recently, biotechnology firms have developed genetically engineered animals, including food animals, such as hogs and salmon. So Food and Water Watch believes that citizens of Illinois and other states have the right to know what types of processes the food they eat has gone through before it reaches them, and a label showing a consumer that a product has GE content would do just that. Labeling food with a processing claim is not a new idea. The USDA certified organic label is a process-based label. Foods that have been irradiated, which is a process, must bear mandatory labels as well. So one of the reasons we believe labeling is important has been addressed by the previous panelists, but I'll just recap by saying the chronic effects of eating GE foods are still largely unknown. And without labeling of GE foods, we cannot associate any health problems with people who ate them because we don't know who ate them. So since the FDA has no way to track adverse health effects in people consuming GE foods, and because there's no requirement that these foods are labeled, we have no effective way to gather data on whether health problems are actually occurring. Also, as we just heard, when it comes to labeling GE foods, the United States lags behind over 60 other developed nations. And that's because the Food and Drug Administration at the federal level does not require these foods to be labeled. They have made that decision, and consumers have been suffering the consequences since the mid-90s. There is no evidence that countries with mandatory labeling regimes have pushed significant extra costs onto these groups. An impartial consulting firm did a study in 2001 for the UK Food Standards Agency and found GE labeling would only increase a household's annual food spending by 0.01 to 0.17%, a figure that ranged from an increase of 33 cents to $5.58 if we adjusted that to 2010 U.S. dollars. An economic assessment conducted by an Emory University professor regarding Prop 37, which was on the ballot last fall in California, concluded that a California family would see a one-time maximum increase in annual food expenditures of $1.27. So we know that cost is an issue. It's always an issue. It's always the conversation that people want to have. So I wanted to spend just a minute kind of working through what the costs might be if you do have a mandatory labeling requirement. So labeling would require testing and segregating seeds according to whether or not they have GE content, and you have to keep that information throughout the food chain. We already do this for lots of other reasons, including identity preserved crops that are being sold as non-GE. Like, these systems to keep these things separate are in place. And they're in place especially when folks are exporting foods to markets that demand this labeling, which are all over the world. Many of our export customers already require this, so these systems exist to serve those markets. If we reach a point where labeling is required in Illinois, the practices may have to be expanded, but it's not recreating the wheel. It's not creating a new system. We're already doing this to serve other purposes, including export customers. Food processors and manufacturers would have to make sure there was proper segregation in crop storage and cleaning equipment, but as long as labeling is maintained throughout the process, this should be a straightforward thing to do. Manufacturers can reduce the costs of actually changing their physical labels by waiting until they need to print new ones, until the inventory is low, and then making that change before they buy new packaging materials, coordinating that labeling addition when they do a design upgrade of their labels, which companies do all of the time. It's true that a GE labeling requirement in Illinois would take monitoring and enforcement, but this doesn't have to be expensive for taxpayers as long as we have the system where the players are maintaining the information throughout the food chain. The state could simply add GE labeling to the food labeling requirements that they would already be assessing during compliance inspections. The Emory University study found a trivial potential impact to the state of California's administrative costs of just an additional 0.03%, which would mean an additional 3 cents for each California resident when they did that calculation for Prop 37. Changing food labeling to reflect the presence of a GE ingredient really wouldn't be any different for grocery stores than stocking a product that has changed its ingredients or added a nutritional benefit claim to the package. At the retail level, the cost for prepackaged foods would be very small because the labels are on there before they get to the store, and long before they get to the store. For foods that the store has to handle, like produce, retailers would have to be sure that they're keeping track of which products are GE and which are non-GE and keep them labeled as such, but they have to do that for pricing. They have to do that for country of origin information. They already know how to keep products separate and attach the relevant information to them. So another big topic has already come up is whose responsibility is this to create this labeling requirement? And this is a hot topic. We hear this all over the place. And we just really always come back to the point that it is not uncommon, sadly, when the federal government has not met the needs of citizens and consumers, that states often have to step up and provide something to fill that need. This is particularly true right now in an era of gridlock in Washington, D.C., where I spend my time, that we're looking to the states to lead on this. And we think that the states have the ability to do so, and we think that they have a responsibility to do so. There are lots of examples ranging from some food labeling and product labeling schemes like Prop 65 in California to mandatory country of origin labeling for foods including seafood, meat, poultry, produce. Before we got that at the federal level, 8 states required this on their own. And it showed that it was workable. No one didn't get product because of it. Companies figured out a way to do it. And then it led to eventually having the widespread interest to do this at the federal level. So we think it's more than reasonable that states are taking the lead on the issue of labeling GE food, because the federal government has failed since the mid-90s to do its job on this issue. The FDA does allow companies to voluntarily label their foods for GE content. And they've allowed that since 1996. But we don't see these labels. The companies have not stepped up to disclose this to consumers. So relying on voluntary labeling and voluntary disclosure of whether genetically engineered content is in the food has not worked. We do know that there is a growing interest for consumers in avoiding genetically engineered content, and in some ways, in some limited ways, the market has responded. So we know that certified organic food can't be produced with genetically engineered ingredients, and there's a growing number of products available with a third-party verified absence label. So these are valuable options for consumers, and you know, and we are happy that they exist, but they're not enough. And relying on these absence labels or relying on companies to voluntarily label products that contain GE ingredients is not an adequate substitute for mandatory GE labeling. All consumers, not just those who are aware of or have access to certified organic or third-party verified products, have a right to know if their food comes from GE crops. And the most efficient way to provide this post-market surveillance for any potential health impacts from consumption of GE food is to affirmatively label them. Not to rely on absence labeling or voluntary labeling that may or may not be complete. So we currently have a right to know how much fat and sodium in our food, and a full list of ingredients is available on nearly every box of food sold in stores, but we don't know if the foods we're eating are genetically engineered, despite consumers' concerns about the impacts these foods may have on public health and the environment. So we urge members of the Illinois legislature to help protect public health by passing SB 1666 and supporting consumers' right to know. Thank you.
Questions on the committee? Yes, Senator Holmes.
Thank you. Because there may be an additional cost incurred by doing this, I think my question is then, why don't we label foods that are not genetically engineered as not genetically engineered, and that could be labeled? Then if there is an increased cost, that would be passed on to those consumers who choose to eat non-genetically engineered foods, and that would basically give the consumer the choice. If we're doing that, similar to how we do organics. I mean, when I go to the grocery store and I look at the produce, there is definitely I have the choice if I want to eat organically grown produce.
Right. So organic organic is a whole set of standards, and it tells you, you know, it's an umbrella label for a whole set of standards that, you know, we are very supportive of organic standards and work to make sure, in fact, today, the rest of the day, I'm going to be working on that, making sure that the standards meet consumer expectations. It's a very transparent process. And so that serves one function. And I think Dr. Hansen's going to talk more about this. One important function, we think, of mandatory labeling of genetically engineered content is a post-market surveillance opportunity that we are now missing. So he's going to speak more about the concerns I know that we have, that his organization has, about the regulatory structure for approving these crops. We are not convinced that the work is being done properly by the right people to say that there's no problem and that there's no potential long-term health impacts. So if we are existing in that system, the least we can do is identify the food so that if we need to track problems, we know who ate it. The best, cleanest way to do that is to track the thing you're looking for. So if we're looking at GE crops, you start with the seed, you carry that information the whole way through, rather than trying to piece together some way to label around it. The cleanest way to have that opportunity to possibly see some effects is to identify where it is.
I just think we're sort of addressing the same thing if we're labeling the foods that are not genetically engineered. And then we just, you go on the assumption, especially since we're talking about, I believe your statistic was 93% of all soybeans are genetically modified. Then we can assume that anything we're eating with soy in it, if it does not say that it is not genetically engineered, that it has been. And I think the same holds true probably for our corn crops, which again have a very high rate of genetic modification.
So there's two pieces of that that I would just add. So one is, you know, for certain crops, we are reaching that point. It's very predominant in certain commodity crops like corn and soy. But it's not a perfect system to tell people to assume if you don't see this voluntary label that something's happening. We think it's a more a more comprehensive, trustworthy approach to say, if you're looking for this, we label this, not to say, assume if you don't see that it's not there, that it's happening. The other piece is, for if we step away from the corn and soy and the major crops, we're going to reach a situation where we see that things are not genetically engineered in a food where there isn't a genetically engineered counterpoint, right? So what if you see olive oil that says non-GE, but there are not yet genetically engineered olives? Is that an appropriate way to track this technology. We think that this just adds layers of complication that we could avoid with a simpler system of labeling where the genetically engineered content is.
Other questions? Yes, Senator Brady?
Yeah.
Please, folks, I'd rather not have any pro or con remarks after speakers. Go ahead, Senator.
You got a fan club anyway.
On time delay, I think, yeah.
You made some comments earlier about when the voluntary program was implemented. When did you say that started?
So when the FDA started to allow the use of these crops, they set a standard that if companies wanted to disclose them, they could.
When?
So from 96 on.
From 90s. And what percentage, do you have any statistics that indicate what, you said not very many have, but do you have any a percentage of
who's
much of
offering
food? Yeah, who is? What percentage of the market is offering that?
I look all the time and I've never seen one. You've been looking for years. I don't think you've ever seen one. We've never seen a company in the U.S. voluntarily say this contains genetically engineered content.
If Illinois were to do this, do you have any estimates on the impact it would have on the cost of food?
So we don't have Illinois-specific estimates. We have, the experience that we've seen with the study I mentioned from the UK. We have some of the analysis that was done around Prop 37, which was slightly different language and slightly different coverage. But we think that the same conditions would apply here and the costs were very low.
Thank you.
Thanks. Senator Frex.
You had made some reference into federal required reporting or labeling, and you said certified organic and irradiation, there are federal standards. There's not a requirement to report or things organic from the federal government, is there?
Right. The point I was making.
There are federal guidelines if they choose to.
Right. So the point that I was making is that it was about a process. So those are examples of labeling for something that is done to the food. So organic is the process you use to raise the crops and process the food. And then irradiated is a federal requirement. So it's considered. Right. Right. FDA has a very similar attitude, I will leave it at that, towards irradiation.
What's a very similar attitude?
We think that FDA is falling down on the job of evaluating the safety of irradiated food, quite frankly, but that's a topic for a different hearing. Okay. But they have a similar attitude in allowing onto the marketplace. But in that case, for that food process, they do require a label that has a symbol, and it says treated, some variation on treated with irradiation that is mandatory.
Okay. I was just confused because I thought irradiated was required and organic wasn't.
So organic is a marketing label, but the point I was making is that it's about the process of raising the food.
All right. Dr. Hansen?
My name is Michael Hansen. I'm a senior scientist at Consumers Union. We're the policy and advocacy arm of Consumer Reports. I've been working on the issue of genetically engineered foods for over 20 years at the state, national, and international level. And in fact, on three separate occasions, I've been invited as an international expert by the World Health Organization, the Food and Agriculture Organization, for these international consultations on, for example, how to do safety assessments on genetically engineered animals. I would just like to point out a number of things. First, there is global agreement that genetic engineering is different than conventional breeding and that there should be required safety assessments. This has been done through Codex Alimentarius. That's the food standards setting organization of the UN. It's jointly run by the World Health Organization and the Food and Agriculture Organization. This is actually its 50th year that it's celebrating. It was an obscure UN agency until 1996, and that's when the Uruguay round of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trades set up the World Trade Organization. And so, written into the World Trade Organization, it turns out the standards and guidelines, everything that comes out of Codex is considered trade legal, right? So that means if Codex says something should be done, if a country does not do that, they can be liable to a WTO challenge. And I would just point out that even though there's global agreement that genetic engineering is different than conventional breeding and there should be required safety assessments, the U.S. is actually the odd person out globally. We do not require safety assessments. We do not recognize that genetic engineering is different than conventional breeding. I'll quickly say that it has been globally agreed that the potential safety problems that can come from genetic engineering include introducing new allergens into plants or increasing levels of allergens that were already there, introducing new plant toxins, changes in nutrition. There can also be unintended consequences. And I'll point out that the FDA back over 21 years ago in 1992, their original policy on genetically engineered plants, it came out of the Council on Competitiveness, out of the White House, and it was out of then Vice President Dan Quayle's office, and it was actually announced on May 28, 1992 at a biotechnology industry organization gathering as a deregulatory initiative. It basically said genetic engineering is just an extension of conventional breeding, therefore the plants will be treated the same under the law. There's no required safety assessments. However, they do this kabuki dance of what are called safety consultations. And so far, there have actually been 97 of those. At the end of this process, at the end of a safety consultation, the companies get a letter from the FDA. I have supplied one of those letters, and it was for the letter that was sent to Monsanto on September 25th, 1996, and it was about their first BT corn variety, Mon 810. And for all those folks that think the FDA has actually made some kind of conclusion about these crops, that's actually not true. I'm going to read a letter from a sentence from that letter that was sent to Monsanto. This, and I should point out that this sentence is in actually all 97 of the safety consultation letters. And this is the FDA writing to Monsanto, quote, based on the safety and nutritional assessment you have conducted, it is our understanding that Monsanto has concluded that corn products derived from this new variety are not materially different in composition, safety, and other relevant parameters from corn currently on the market, and that the genetically modified corn does not raise issues that would require pre-market review or approval by FDA, end quote. So for all the 97 crops that have gone through this process, that sentence is in all of them. The only difference is whatever crop it is and whatever company it is. So very clearly, this shows the FDA has not made a conclusion about the safety of engineered plants or of the technology as a whole. It just understands the company thinks there's no problem. And I'll point out, since 1992, it turns out in 2001, the FDA functionally admitted that that original policy was wrong. Because in 2001, they proposed, it was called the Pre-Market Biotech Notification policy, and that's where they proposed that the companies would notify the government 120 days before they commercialized a new genetically engineered plant variety, and they would be required to submit data. And here is from that rule. This is as part of that rule. The FDA admitted that genetic engineering was different than conventional breeding and that the process of what's called insertional mutagenesis could cause problems, and that's why they would want data on each separate transformation event. This is the FDA speaking, and this is in the background of that new policy in 2001. Quote, because of some recombinant DNA-induced unintended changes are specific to a transformational event, e.g., those resulting from insertional mutagenesis, FDA believes that it needs to be provided with information about foods from all separate transformation events, even when the agency has been provided with information about foods from rDNA-modified plants with the same intended trait and has had no questions about such foods. In contrast, the agency does not believe it needs to receive information about foods from plants derived through narrow crosses, end quote. Narrow crosses are conventional breeding. So right there, that is the FDA admitting that there is a difference that could cause a health problem, and that's why they would want data on each separate transformation event. But guess what? The FDA is still regulating under the 1992 policy and not the 2001, because neither of those policies were ever finalized. So they've functionally admitted that there is a difference and there should be required safety assessments, but they're still acting as though there is none. I would also point out that last year, in June of 2012, the American Medical Association's House of Delegates actually changed their position on their policy on what they call bioengineered foods. While they do not support labeling, they did switch their position to now They support mandatory pre-market safety assessment. As they themselves say, quote, our AMA supports mandatory pre-market systematic safety assessments of bioengineered foods, end quote. And then they actually say that you should look at a number of areas. What I want to point out is when you go from a position that it would be a good idea to look at these safety issues to saying that you support mandatory pre-market systematic safety assessments, you've just admitted that there could be an unintended health consequence. And we already know that 97 of these products have gone through this process without required safety assessments. And so it seems to me the only reason that you label is you need to be able to track these unintended consequences. In the language of Codex, in the document that was on risk management, it basically said you use risk management measures to deal with scientific uncertainty. And then paragraph 19 says those risk management measures may include labeling. And so labeling is a way to deal with scientific uncertainty. It's basically a risk management measure to look for these unintended consequences. And that's, I think, why you have to have that policy. I'd also point out, besides the AMA and FDA, there's also considerable evidence of potential health issues with engineered foods. For example, the FDA is poised to approve genetically engineered salmon that would supposedly reach market weight in half the time of wild salmon. However, the company's own data suggests that it may exhibit increased allergenicity. Another large problem with these safety assessments is there have been very few long-term animal feeding studies, particularly studies that are done with the engineered plant grown under the conditions that it's meant to be used. So, for example, the herbicide-tolerant plants, which is the vast majority that's out there, that would be a plant that is not only an engineered soybean, but has also been sprayed with Roundup, since that's what it's supposed to do. I will point out that there has been a carefully designed meta-analysis that was done of 19 published feeding studies involving mammals fed either engineered corn or soy. This is all the data that could be found in the literature. It was also data from some of the companies that had to be gotten via lawsuits over in Europe. There was a lawsuit in Germany which forced all the data on Monsanto's BT corn rootworm. That meta-analysis, what it did is it looked at all the raw data and it found that there were statistically significant increases in damage to the kidney, liver, and bone marrow. And those are could indicate potential indicators of an onset of chronic diseases. However, at this point, no animal tests are obligatory for any of the genetically engineered plants cultivated on a large scale in the U.S. There's a second review article that I gave you a copy of, and that looked at all the scientific papers published between 1980 and 2010 that dealt with the potential adverse health or toxic effects of GE or transgenic plants, and it used both the PubMed and the Scopus databases. And this review article found, quote, a certain equilibrium in the number of research groups suggesting on the basis of their studies that a number of varieties of GM products, mainly maize and soybeans, are as safe and nutritious as the respective conventional non-GM plant, and those still raising serious concerns was observed. Moreover, it is worth mentioning that most of the studies demonstrating that GM foods are as nutritional and safe as those obtained by conventional breeding have been performed by biotechnology companies or their associates, end quote. I would also point out that a second review of 94 feeding studies found, quote, a strong association between author affiliation to industry, that is potential conflict of interest, and the study outcome in terms of health risk or nutritional assessment. Basically, they found that when there's either industry funding or industry affiliation, you tend to find that there's no problem with the food. So most of the findings of adverse effects have come from independent funded studies. Those are clearly needed more. I will point out that a long-term independent feeding study was published last October last year, and it found that GE corn caused tumors and premature death. This study was done by Dr. Eric Giles, Cerellini, and colleagues. When it came out, it was viciously attacked in the media by pro-GE and industry-affiliated scientists in what appears to have been an orchestrated campaign. The two main criticisms of that study was that he used too few rats per group, that they only used 10 rats per group, and that they used a strain of rat, the Sprague Dolly rats, that are so susceptible to mammary tumors that they've actually said that it is a violation of animal welfare to allow these rats to live out their full lifespan since they get so many mammary tumors. Both those criticisms are off base. I would point out that the sample size of 10 rats per group that Sarah Laney took blood and biochemical measurements on, that was actually the same exact number of rats per sample size that Monsanto took when it published a study on NK603 on the same corn plant published in the same journal 8 years before. So if 10 rats per group is too small to demonstrate an adverse effect, how come all these companies submit it and say that there's no problem and they only have 10 rats per group? That's not being consistent. As for the strain of rat used, the Sprague Dowley, part of the reason that Sarah Laney did that was to reproduce the Monsanto study, only do it more properly with isolines and everything, and let it run for 2 years rather than 90 days. If he would have used a different strain of rat, then you'd have to know if you saw anything in the long-term study, was it due to the longer-term feeding, or could it be due to the strain of rat? So that's why they use the same strain of Sprague Dowley rat. And I would also point out that when Monsanto re-registered glyphosate in the European Union, they had to do a 2-year feeding study just of glyphosate. Guess what? They used those Sprague Dowley rats in a 2-year feeding study. So why is it unacceptable if Sarah Laney uses them, but perfectly okay if Monsanto or any of the other companies use them? Finally, I should point out that both the French Food Safety Agency and the European Food Safety Authority have actually agreed with Dr. Sarah Laney that long-term safety assessments should be done. In fact, the French Food Safety Agency, ANSES, their report on the Sarah Laney study notes, quote, ANSES recommends initiating studies and research on the long-term effects of GMOs in combination with plant protection products and calls for public funding on the national and European level to enable large-scale studies and research for consolidating knowledge of insufficiently documented health risks, end quote. At a meeting in December last year, the, quote, the EFSA board meeting on Thursday last week, said there was agreement that long-term studies were needed and it was just a question of how to fund them, end quote. If this the Sarah Laney study is so flawed, why have ANSES and EFSA functionally agreed with its calls for independently funded long-term feeding studies on GE crops? Finally, on June 28th of this year, the European Commission announced they were spending 3 million euros. They're going to fund a 2-year carcinogenicity study on the same GE corn variety, NK603, that Dr. Sarah Laney and colleagues use. So they actually put out a request for proposals on June 28th. They're redoing that feeding study with larger numbers and properly done, and they're spending 3 million euros on it. So if that study was completely false, as so many people claim, how come the Europeans are now spending 3.5 million? U.S. dollars. Finally, I would point out that there's virtually no independent safety testing of these crops in the U.S. due to intellectual property rights problems. When farmers buy GE seed in the U.S., they have to sign a product stewardship agreement, which forbids them not only from saving the seed, but from giving those seeds to researchers. In early 2009, 26 public sector scientists in the U.S. took the unprecedented step of writing to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency protesting, quote, as a result of restricted access, no truly independent research can legally be conducted on many critical questions regarding this technology, end quote. As a result, the editors of Scientific American published a perspective stating, quote, we also believe food safety and environmental protection depends on making plant products available to regular scientific scrutiny. Agricultural technology companies should therefore immediately remove the restrictions on research from their end user agreements, end quote. We concur and believe that only truly independent safety tests will give us an answer about the safety of these engineered foods. In the meantime, it's crucial that the foods are labeled so that if people experience any negative effects, they and their doctors can identify them. And finally, you've been told about all the besides the question raised by the long-term feeding studies, and because of allergy issues, and I'd say because consumers have a basic right to know what they're eating, Consumers Union has always supported labeling of engineered foods. Consumers Union is also part of a global network of consumer organizations called Consumers International. We have 220 members in 115 countries, and CI believes this fully. That's why there's now 62 countries, including more than half the world population, that requires labeling. I'll just point out, just this year, we added India onto that. And then a number of polls between 1995 and 2011 have found between 70 and 95% of Americans polled supported mandatory labeling. And so, bottom line, we support labeling of engineered foods and support SB 1666. And I'll point out in my testimony, all the references I've made to studies or other things are there in the footnotes, and where possible, when they're available on the internet, I've concluded those links. And I would like to end by answering one of Senator Holmes' questions. You asked why aren't we also requiring the labeling of meat, milk, eggs, and cheese from animals fed GE foods? And the answer to that is, when you look in Europe and elsewhere, it is a process, right? So that first you require full labeling, because there's going to be more of an effect if people are directly eating the food than if it's being processed through an animal. But there is actually a move in Europe to move next toward requiring labeling of foods from animals that have been treated. Now, for your question of why do this on a state by a state basis rather than a federal level, I think, as Patty said, sometimes the states have to take the lead when the federal government doesn't. That happened with COOL, and I think what's going to happen here is there will be a federal labeling, but what's going to happen is it is going to take either one of the states, such as Washington, to pass a bill, or if we get two more states in the Northeast, because we already have Connecticut and Maine. In Vermont, the House has passed it, and it will go to the Senate in January, and I believe they'll pass it. So if we get two more states in the Northeast, then labeling would kick in there. As soon as labeling happens in one of these states, there will be actual something happening at the federal level. And I can tell you, for some of us that have been involved in this for decades, there are already people working on the end game right now, but nothing is going to happen federally until one of the states passes it, and then that will be the trigger, because you have to put this in a global context. We cannot meet the Codex guidelines. So what we've been trying to get the U.S. to do is simply meet what the global guidelines are. These people that talk about genetic engineering is really no different. We've been doing it for many years. That's just wrong. There's global agreement that that's not true. And that's written into WTO. So we don't want to see U.S. products discriminated against in international markets for reasons that they could right now. Right now, that the Codex plant guidelines, they're strict enough that any country could require stringent safety testing and all this data on these engineered crops, and then they could turn around and block anything they wanted coming from the U.S. And if the U.S. took that country to the World Trade Organization, the U.S. would lose. And believe me, the U.S. knows that. At these Codex meetings, I was at virtually all of them. I've been behind closed doors with the U.S. delegation. They know that they can't meet this global standard. All we're trying to do is get the U.S. to come up to that standard. And that's why I think states like Illinois, if you pass this, you will basically spur that national legislation you want. It will not happen without one of the states going first. But as soon as that happens, many of these companies, they're global. They see what's going on all over the world. China, India, everywhere, they're requiring labeling. We're one of the last holdouts. And I think that one thing I've noticed difference over the last 20 years is these labeling bills have been in these states literally for 15 years. And none of them have been able to move anywhere. And we're now starting to see they're moving through. And passing. So I think the times are changing. There's more data coming out that raise questions about some of these crops. And I'll just end there and thank you.
Let me just mention a couple of our colleagues have joined us. Senator Mandy Hunter was here, and Senator Jim Oberweis was here. Are they still here? Oh, there you are. Senator, welcome. I have just a question for you, a comment. I think that you're hitting at the crux of really the issue. And certainly we're debating 1666, which is a food labeling bill. But the real issue is food safety. Having visited the Farm Progress Show, I mean, there's some very good things about technology that have created crops that have been able to withstand the drought conditions that we're experiencing right now, and that's certainly good for consumers because of our dependence upon agricultural products in this country. But I think that the issue and what concerns me most is why hasn't the testing been adequate, and why isn't it objective so that as consumers we know? And I'll tell you what drives this for at least me and for my family. And we've seen over the generations all of a sudden diseases that were kind of remote now becoming commonplace. My mother has Alzheimer's, and I've been to a number of seminars, and I'm involved with the Alzheimer's group locally just because I want to understand what that is. Where is that coming from? Is it because we're drinking soda out of aluminum cans? I mean, what is it about our environment that has changed? Autism. I serve on the board of Easter Seals in Peoria. We have seen such an explosion of diagnosis of children with autism. And again, just as a parent, as a grandparent, I have to ask the question, where is this coming from? What is it that it's about our environment or about our food system that is causing certain things to happen? And certainly I don't, as the sponsor of the bill, wish any ill harm on Monsanto or any other company that uses technology to try to better our life and better the conditions for farmers across the country. But somewhere in there, I guess I want to see some objectivity that says, here's what we're doing and here are the risks, or here are how we've mitigated the risks, or something that can assure us that we're moving in the right direction. And so is there any place where this objective research, I know you've cited some examples there, but why have we not taken this on within this country?
I think the problem in the U.S. is this intellectual property rights concerns, because literally if a scientist wants to do a certain study, they have to let the company know this is what we plan to do, and the company can either say yes or no. And I can tell you example after example of scientists that, for example, wanted to do further studies and were told, no, sorry, we don't like that. For example, Gunther Stotsky at New York University, it was his lab that first showed that with the BT crops, the endotoxin that they're putting in is streaming out of the roots into the soil and actually can have an impact on soil microorganisms. And actually, they were able to show that the level in the soil was high enough that it could affect caterpillars and that. He had found that for certain varieties. When he tried to go to Monsanto and said, we'd like to look at a number of your other plants, they came back and said, no, we don't particularly care for this research. We don't think it's important. So, no, you can't have access. And that's what the real problem is. The way science works is it's through the free flow of asking questions. Since these crops are patented, you literally have to get approval from the companies. There's now been an agreement that many of these universities have now signed that they will allow them to do some research, but all those agreements that supposedly overcame these problems I talked about, all those agreements are secret. They won't make them public. And when I talk to scientists behind the scenes, there are certain things I would love to see. For example, when you sequence this, part of the problem with GE is this insertional mutagenesis. You have no control over where you're inserting things, and if they start moving around within the genome, they can cause problems. Well, one way you could easily answer that question is you sequence what you've inserted, and then you look at the so-called flanking regions. If they stay the same generation after generation, that tells you that the trait is stable. If those bordering regions are changing, that tells you that the gene is moving around. Monsanto, I've not found a single scientist that Monsanto has allowed to do that sequencing information. There's been some work done in Europe, and they do indeed find that these things are moving. And so there's that concern there. And then finally, I would like to say the example you brought up, that the supposed benefits of engineered crops, such as this GE drought-tolerant crop that was put out, if you actually look at the environmental assessment that USDA put out with that, if you read it carefully, you'll see that that engineered drought-tolerant crop doesn't do any better than, for example, DuPont's non-engineered drought-tolerant corn. So there's no real evidence that it increases drought tolerance or other things. And these supposed other benefits, I just want to, most of them aren't there.
Any other questions from the committee? Senator Frex.
I do have a question, and I'll probably ask the next panel that comes up as well. You had talked about how the systems are already in place for export of foods to segregate crops. What do you think that adds an additional cost? So I'm pretty sure you could do this. It is being done, but how much more are we, are people buying our export products paying for that?
It doesn't, look, this is what the market wants. I don't think there's much more being paid. And one thing Patty didn't mention is David Byrne, who was then...
Was it the market wants or what the governments of those countries wants?
No, it's actually what the market wants, not necessarily the governments, because it's the markets that are often saying we don't want this. So, for example, what has just happened this week, well, it was revealed late last week, but there is a someone in Washington State that bought non-engineered alfalfa seeds and grew it for export, and it was being exported to the Middle East, and when they tested it, it turned up positive. And Dubai, the United Arab Emirates, and Saudi Arabia, even though only Saudi Arabia has a mandatory labeling law, none of those countries ban GE stuff, but they won't buy any of it. And so now there's this big concern. I would say that I haven't seen any evidence that it increases costs, and I would just point out that David Byrne, who is the acting EU commissioner for public health, was quoted over 10 years ago of saying the same thing. Industry told us we were going to see double-digit increases in the cost of food when the EU required labeling. They didn't see that. Norway, which actually requires more stringent labeling than any other country in the world, they didn't see any increase in food costs. So countries which have required labeling, there hasn't been any evidence of increased food costs so far.
But if it's fact that this is what the market wants, and you cite studies that say 75 to 90% of the public wants labeling, then why is there not a market here in this states, in the States for that? Why are businesses then not offering more non-GMO?
Well, you do have, through the non-GMO project, you do have, they're now up to 8,000 products that are labeled, and they finally have gotten an approval from USDA, because all labels that are on meat products actually have to be go through approved. The USDA. And so they actually have a label that meat grown without animals that have been fed engineered grains. And also the issue of, I should point out, if this bill did require labeling of meat products, for example, that would be illegal, because the Federal Meat Inspection Act and the Poultry Product Inspection Act explicitly says that all labeling of meat products have to go through the USDA. So
we are getting to the end of our hour. One quick question, because I want to make sure we're out of here on time and give the other panel.
Yeah, my concern is with a lot of your testimony that we're sort of mixing an awful lot of apples and oranges here. It sounds like there's a lot of things that need to be done at the federal level. You're saying the FDA needs to be doing things, that there needs to be this pre-market testing of right. things, all of which is not going to be impacted by 1666 here, the bill that we're talking about.
But labeling allows you to track if there's any unintended health consequence. And that's the reason why it needs to be done, because there can be all this non-labeled food, but yes, 93% of soybeans are engineered, 88% of corn is engineered, but as we know, 80 to 85% of that's not going into the human food chain, it's going into the animal feed chains and elsewhere. And I would point out, Consumer Reports, 10 years ago when we tested, 50% of the soy acreage was engineered. The highest levels we found were in infant formula at 2% of the soy was engineered. All the other food products where we detected soy, it was at 0.5%, which was 10 times lower. No, 100 times lower than the level that was occurring nationwide, which suggested to us that there was actually segregation going on. So the reason you have to have labeled is because all the stuff that's unlabeled, you don't know what contains engineered and what doesn't. And that's why you need it to track safety
right.
issues.
And I certainly understand your point. I'm just thinking, again, this seems to be something that is more of a federal issue. Do any of the countries that have restrictions on these products, did they start out by any villages or separate states doing this, or are they as a country? I mean, you mentioned France. That's a country. So are these other countries, it's throughout their entire country that is...
Well, in some of those countries, you did have regions that decided to go, for example, GMO-free first and then move, and now some of those countries are trying to be GMO-free countries. So that's not quite labeling, because they got the labeling they want very early in the European Union. That came in over 10 years ago, so very soon.
All right, we're at the end of our hour. I want to give equal time to the opponents of this. Thank you very much, panelists. Will the opponents please come and take seats? Again, we will need to... vacate the room, and we'll try to be out of here by about 1:45. But if the panelists would please individually introduce yourselves, and then we'll start with whoever you want to start with. So, David, do you want to start introducing yourself?
Thanks. I'm David Miller. I'm the CEO of iBio here in Illinois.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Louis Finkel. I'm the Executive Vice President of Government Affairs for the Grocery Manufacturers Association.
Stephen Moose, Professor at the University of Illinois.
Say that again, Stephen.
Yeah, Stephen Moose, Professor of Crop Science at the University of Illinois. I teach a course in biotechnology and agriculture.
Katie Pratt, farmer.
And who wants to start?
Chairman Kaler and distinguished members of the subcommittee and Senate staff, fellow witnesses on both sides and fellow citizens, thank you very much for the opportunity to testify here today. I'd like to thank Senator Kaler for the very even-handed way he, as a sponsor and a believer in this bill, has conducted these hearings. And I'd like to thank Russell Orrell of the Senate President's staff for his help on keeping us all in marching forward. And thanks, Senators Frerich, Holmes, McCann, and today Brady for attending these things. I've got a written testimony that you have before you. Because of the limits of time, I'm not going to go through all that, but I commend it to your reading, including a shout-out to Senator Kaler for his kindness and something of mutual concern, which is good, wholesome bread when I first met him on the first day. I'm Dave Miller. I'm the President and CEO of Illinois Biotechnology Industry Organization. It's better known as iBio. And indeed, biotech activities in human health, agriculture, and bioindustrial sectors are energetically pursued in every single county in Illinois. The biotech ag side is contributing $28.4 billion in Illinois economic output, $572 million in state and local taxes. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation recently awarded $25 million to the University of Illinois Institute for Genomic Biology to find out how GMO crops can offset drought and disruptions caused by human activity that changes the global climate. And we typically rank number two in the U.S. for corn and soy, which are overwhelmingly GMO. And so the argument here is that we should put a label on Illinois crops to imply to the world that we think that they're unsafe. I want to do several things here because my main point has not been covered in these hearings. I want to underline three key points that have been made. I want to take all the arguments that the proponents have raised and address them thoroughly. And then I want to talk about why I'm so passionate and why I'm so passionately against these kind of bills. I'm going to ask you to refer to the written testimony because there's some graphics here, and I apologize to the audience, but we will post this on the iBio website so you can get your hands on it and take a look at it. First point is we've been genetically modifying foods for thousands of years. On this page, you can see what corn used to look like and what it looks like today. On the next page, you can see what a banana used to look like and what it looks like today. It used to look like a plantain, a tough little plantain with watermelon seeds in it. The same could be true of a set of oranges and tomatoes. We've just mangled the genome. We've changed it. We've really done a number on the genome. What's different today is that, as the earlier gentleman said, is we're doing this with much more precision, and that's depicted on this Cornell University chart in your handouts. And we're not only doing it with more precision, but I would say, to use the vernacular, we are regulating this up the wazoo. And the regulatory scheme, which somebody said we didn't have, of the FDA, USDA, and FDA are portrayed on the graphic that's in your packets there. Now, in the case of the banana, which I think is one of the most popular fruits in the world, there's a real problem. We've got wind-borne spores that are threatening the entire world banana crop, and we've got another disease that causes the bananas to dry up and die. Now, we have so mangled the genome of the banana that scientists believe that the only way we're going to save the banana crop worldwide is to genetically alter the banana so it can fight against these diseases. One of the diseases, you need massive amounts of insecticide and pesticide to cure it. The other one, there is no cure. So the scientists say if we tweak a couple genes on the banana, we may save the crop. Now notice it's okay with the anti-GMO folks to take this thing from a little nubby plantain full of watermelon seeds and completely change the nature of the fruit to be the banana, but it's not okay to change one or two genes to protect the harvest worldwide. So that's the argument that we're dealing with. That's point number one. We've been doing this for a long time. The difference is now we're doing it more precisely and we're regulating up the wazoo. Number two, genetically foods are safe. They've been found to be safe or more safe and of higher quality than conventionally grown foods by a blue chip who's who of worldwide scientific organizations. Some of those organizations are printed in the handout in your packet. And I wasn't going to read this in the interest of time, but since the last gentleman made some goofy claims, I'm going to read what the European Commission said is the main conclusion to be drawn from the efforts of more than 130 research projects covering a period of more than 25 years of research and involving more than 500 independent research groups is that biotechnology, and in particular GMOs, are no more risky than conventional plant breeding techniques. The German similar group said, in some cases, food from GM plants appear to be superior in respect to health. And that bogus study that you've been thrown at—it's been thrown at you twice. First in the first hearing today, just a few minutes ago, on the French study, was repudiated by the six French science academies, who said the study provides no scientific information regarding the detection of any health risk. Further, as a nation, we have ingested an estimated 3 trillion meals, which included GMO food ingredients, without any documented ill effects. No sneezes, no coughs, certainly no illnesses or deaths to show for them. The food is safe, and during all these hours of hearings, no one has produced any credible, peer-reviewed science suggesting they're not. No one. No one has produced anything of the sort. Third, GMO foods are an environmental boon. A Nebraska farmer at a conference I was recently at said that his use of GMO crops has caused a 70% reduction in herbicide and pesticide use, 50% less fuel use, an 80% reduction in chemical runoff from his farm, and 93% less soil erosion. In fact, studies show that GMO attributable global reductions in herbicide and pesticide adds up to about close to 18%. In 2010 alone, the reduction in greenhouse gas emission was equivalent to removing 8.6 million automobiles from the road. So it's an environmental boon. Now, I want to deal with these arguments that have been thrown at you time after time. Here are the arguments. There's three of them. There's three basic arguments. One, prompted, big majorities of consumers say they want GMO labeling on foods. That's true. Prompted questions can generate answers out of kilter with how folks view things in the total context of their lives. In prompted polls I've seen since becoming president of iBio, a large minority of U.S. consumers and a majority of Europeans do not want food that contains genes. And, of course, genes are in everything that lives or has once lived, plants and animals. Prompted, I'll bet most folks would say they don't want food grown in feces. Should we label organic foods with a note saying, attention, this food or ingredients therein were grown in feces? Add a little information and the poll results change. Colorado State University, for example, found that in a prompted poll, respondents favoring labeling would not be willing to pay extra to have the foods labeled. Now, in unprompted polls I've seen from time to time, asking folks about what concerns them, less than 1% of consumers listed concerns about food ingredients as a problem. And in one prompted poll, when they asked if biotech agriculture would, quote unquote, benefit you or your family, unquote, 20% of the respondents said no, 35% said yes, and the most frequent reason for saying yes was that biotech would bring better health and nutrition. So that's so much for the prompted polls. Number two, consumers have, quote unquote, a right to know. This claim that folks have a right to know is kind of like, sounds good, it's like mom and apple pie. And certainly in an age in Google where you can find out doggone near anything in about 20 seconds, it sounds really, really familiar. The problem is that's not what this bill is saying. And I salute Patty Lavera for being honest about it. This bill is saying certain consumers who have what amounts to an aesthetic food preference may force people and companies to involuntarily tell us no. Now, first of all, that right doesn't exist in U.S. law. The Second Court of Appeals ruled over a decade ago that labeling mandates based solely on an alleged consumer's right to know rather than on a product's measurable characteristics violate the U.S. Constitution's First Amendment. The court wrote, there is no end to the information that states could require manufacturers to disclose about their production methods. And you have to ask yourself, as policymakers, just as the court did, where would this end? If I'm devoutly religious, do I have a right to know what faith the folks who harvested my food are? Don't I have a right to know? Or how about this? How about this? Bean sprouts, cantaloupe, and spinach grown organically have been associated with death and injury in the U.S. and abroad. Don't consumers have a right to know via a label on organics that says this food or ingredients therein were cultivated using a methodology associated with death and injury in human beings due to E. coli and salmonella poisoning? Don't we have a right to know? As the court said, where does it stop? Third argument. Medicines are genetically engineered, and they put labels on medicines. Why shouldn't they put labels on GMOs? Now, Senator Kaler has asked this question a few times, and I think it's a heck of a good question because the answer highlights the fact that the GMO techniques in foods are also used in the development of life-saving medicines. I can't help wondering how many of the anti-GMO folks in today's audience would reject on behalf of a loved one, the latest and greatest GMO cure for cancer or rheumatoid arthritis, if it meant saving that loved one from a death sentence or a life of crippling pain. If I could have order, sir. Now, A new biologic medicine goes through many years and hundreds of millions of dollars, maybe billions of dollars worth of testing. The studies performed by universities and companies are then reviewed by the FDA. This is the same process that the proponents of Senate Bill 1666 complain about. Even then, drugs get through the trials and have to be recalled later on. Remember those diet drugs a few years ago? When the sample size was thousands, they got through and they looked fine. But when the sample size out in the market post-approval became millions instead of thousands, deadly side effects showed up. Again, as a side, I would bet my iBio members and the biopharma companies, most of them north of here, would love to have a sample size of 3 trillion doses as we've had with GMO foods, because they'd have much more confidence in their drug safety. But the government doesn't require labeling of the medicines as GMO. They label the side effects that all those trials reveal are the real problem. They label where there's a studied scientific basis to label. And here, as the FDA, USDA, AMA, World Health Organization, American Association for the Advancement of Science, among many others, have pointed out, there is no scientific basis to label. To do with medicines what this bill would do with foods, we'd have to mandate big signs on the sides of clinics and hospitals warning patients and the general public that some of the medicines prescribed and dispensed within those hospitals are made with GMOs. I think the General Assembly of Illinois would find that an idiotic proposition, as well they should. Now, although the anti-GMO focus is on labeling, the real aim of the activists is to use fear and hysteria to generate an outright ban on these safe and nutritional foods. And this is not David Miller saying this. On the next page, you'll see statements by folks from the so-called Center for Food Safety and Greenpeace admitting that the whole pro-labeling effort is to put a skull and crossbones on this food with the idea of taking it off the market. So the question you have to ask as policymakers is, do you want to assist the anti-GMO folks in these efforts? By far the biggest problem generated by these anti-GMO rants, coupled with the destructive activities of the anti-GMO activists in fields and greenhouses, is that they, one, have kept farmers in Africa in a state of dire poverty. If they haven't killed people, already, they almost assuredly will kill millions in years to come. And our three are going to literally make people sick and blind them. These facts were made overwhelmingly clear by Robert Paulberg, a distinguished professor at Wellesley College, in a book with an introduction by Nobel Prize winners Norman Borlaug and Jimmy Carter. He documents in devastating detail the poverty and malnourishment caused in Africa by the discouragement of modern farming techniques and GMO. Borlaug and Carter wrote in their introduction, "This is a rich world argument that is hurting the poor. Responsible biotechnology is not our enemy. Hunger and starvation are. It gets worse." Scientific American, the New York Times, and others documented the recent destruction of trials of golden rice in the Philippines, an act of vandalism heartily cheered on and applauded by Greenpeace and other anti-GMO activists. Now, golden rice is a strain developed to generate beta-carotene in hopes of reducing or eliminating the blindness of 500,000 people a year, half of whom die from this deficiency. Although testing has determined that the product is safe, the anti-GMO forces have delayed its development and distribution in the Philippines, China, and Asia, using, as Scientific American called it, misinformation and hysteria. Thousands of scientists worldwide, recoiling in revulsion at this barbaric act, have since signed a statement in support of GMOs. There are currently in the world, today, 1 billion under or malnourished people, and we expect to add 2 to 2.5 billion people to the population by 2050. Experts such as Robert Thompson, senior fellow at the Chicago Council of Global Affairs, projects that we will have to roughly double the planet's food production by then. Feeding all these people and keeping them from getting sick is going to amount to a race of technology against time, and the Gates Foundation and scientists around the world expect GMOs to play a huge role in providing food security for our fellow humans. Professor Thompson stated it would be unconscionable to deprive GMO from the world's poor. So again, senators, I applaud the professional way these hearings have been conducted. Now let us table this bill and let us resist efforts to ban GMO foods because they are safe and nutritious, because they're a huge boon to the environment, because Illinois is a leader in their development and production, but most of all, because the lives of millions of people around the world are at stake. I'd be
happy to answer
any questions.
We're going to have order.
I know the truth hurts.
Yeah, we're going to have order in this room, please. Any questions from the committee members? I have some questions, but I want to hear the rest of the panel before I come back to it, David.
Thank you.
Yep. Next speaker, please.
I'm going to move David's props.
Okay.
Good morning, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee. My name is Lewis Finkel, and again, I serve as Executive Vice President of Government Affairs for the Grocery Manufacturers Association, the Washington, D.C.-based voice of 300 leading food, beverage, and consumer products companies. On behalf of GMA, I'd like to take this opportunity to register our opposition to SB1666 and the concept of mandated labeling of genetically modified foods and beverages. This morning, I'll offer abbreviated oral remarks that summarize the written submission I provided to the committee in advance of the hearing. GMA and its member companies are committed to providing consumers with the safest possible products and foods and beverages containing ingredients derived from genetically engineered plants are safe. Accordingly, we believe that this legislation is deeply flawed, as it would impose a mandatory label that suggests food products derived from biotechnology are potentially unsafe for consumption. Such a label would be inherently misleading, as noted by the Food and Drug Administration, as there is overwhelming agreement among regulatory and scientific bodies in the United States and around the world that these products are in fact safe and without nutritional distinction. Ensuring the safety of our products and maintaining the confidence of consumers is the single most important goal of our industry. Genetic engineering technology simply adds desirable traits to a plant without introducing anything unnatural or using chemicals so that crops can grow quicker, use fewer pesticides, use less water, and are more plentiful. Further, genetic engineering is not new. It's been in use for the past 20 years. Today, foods with ingredients derived from genetic engineered plants make up 70 to 80% of the foods we eat every day, whether at home or away from home, because they require fewer pesticides, less water, and keep production costs down. And in fact, GM technology helps reduce the price of crops used for food, such as corn, soybeans, and sugar beets, by as much as 15 to 30%. In addition, genetically modified foods and ingredients are also used to help feed the hungry and malnourished in developing nations around the world, as David previously noted. GMA supports the U.S. Food and Drug Administration's existing science-based labeling policy, and I want to emphasize the science-based labeling policy, with respect to foods and food ingredients derived from modern biotechnology. We believe that the FDA policy provides a comprehensive framework for consumer protection and choice and clearly serves the public interest. That framework and approach is also supported by global scientific bodies and regulatory agencies, including the World Health Organization, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, the National Academy of Science, and the American Medical Association, who agree that foods and beverages that contain ingredients derived from genetically engineered plants are safe and that these ingredients are materially no different from those derived from conventional plants. All foods, whether or not they are produced using biotechnology, are regulated by the Food and Drug Administration, or USDA, for their individual safety, toxicity, and the presence of allergens. It should be noted that genetic modification is a process and not an ingredient. Like selective breeding and other agricultural techniques, including planting, harvesting, and even irrigation methods, the biotechnology that is the subject of this legislation is merely a process. Special mandatory labeling imposed above and beyond what FDA currently requires could mislead consumers into believing that foods produced through modern biotechnology are somehow different or present a special risk or potential risk, even though FDA and other scientific bodies have studied these foods exhaustively and determined them to be safe and nutritious. In addition to safety, providing consumer choice is a core value of our industry. If this legislation is intended to address consumer choice, I would argue that those choices already exist. Individuals who make a personal decision not to consume foods containing ingredients derived from genetically engineered plants can easily avoid such products simply by purchasing products that are certified organic. In Illinois and throughout the U.S., consumers already have access to a wide variety of product choices that are certified organic under the U.S. Department of Agriculture's National Organic Program, which provides for a not a mandatory label, a voluntary label, as was discussed on the previous panel. By definition, products that are certified organic do not contain genetically engineered ingredients. In addition, consumers may also purchase products that companies have voluntarily, and I want to emphasize voluntarily, labeled as not containing genetically engineered ingredients. While I most certainly acknowledge the role and responsibility of the legislature to act to protect the interests of consumers of this state, the scientific consensus in support of safety and nutritional equivalence of foods derived from biotechnology leads to the conclusion that the public is not at risk. However, consumers would be harmed by both confusion and increased costs as a result of imposing a mandatory label. I would also highlight for the committee that some of the deeply flawed inconsistencies in the bill that have been discussed earlier, the broad exemptions. If the matters this bill attempts to address are so paramount and of such an abiding interest to the legislature, then why are these exemptions included? Why do they exist? In many cases, these exemptions are applied in just the place where a consumer arguably knows the least about the foods and beverages he or she may be consuming, like restaurants and food carts and possibly vending machines. These arbitrary exemptions seem to be designed solely to cut certain element of commerce out of the debate rather than assist the consumer. To conclude, given that FDA and numerous other scientific and regulatory bodies that I've previously mentioned have determined that food products containing ingredients derived from genetically engineered plants are safe and that they are materially no different from the conventional counterparts, a mandatory label declaring the presence of these ingredients does not provide the consumer with any information that is useful or actionable. The limited space on a food label should be reserved for critically important food safety and nutritional information that can allow consumers to make safe and healthful choices. Thank you for your time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Members of the committee, Senator Holmes.
I think you touched on a point that I had not even thought of before. So you're telling me that while the food that I buy at the grocery store has to be labeled, if I go out to eat, that food's not going to be, I'm not going to have any knowledge?
Yes, ma'am, that's correct.
So whether I'm, you know, grabbing a Big Whopper from Burger King or going to the, you know, Morton's or something, I'm not going to know if that food's been genetically engineered.
That's correct, ma'am.
So I'm not going to know if the food I eat at restaurants is genetically engineered, and I'm not going to know if the meat, milk, eggs, or any animal have been fed genetically engineered foods.
Only processed and packaged.
So if I'm actually trying to say that I want no genetically engineered foods in my diet whatsoever, that's going to be awfully hard to do. It basically means I have to either grow up myself or go to the grocery store and buy organic and not eat meat.
Or make those determinations through the process by which those that make those choices now do.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Other questions? All right. Thank you.
Well, thank you, everyone, for... I don't have any big titles to add to the end of my name or anything, and I don't have a lot of stats to offer, and some of what I do say is a little bit repetitive, but I'm going to say it anyway. I do thank you for your time to allow me to speak with you today and share information about how biotechnology is used on our farm. My husband and I farm with his family, raising corn, soybeans, seed corn, and farm kids. Just two of them, that's enough. I am a fourth generation farmer. My husband is the seventh generation of his family to farm. So literally, our farming efforts today are founded on family legacy, and it is one we strive to do right by every day. Decision making on our farm is a serious task. My husband, father-in-law, and brother-in-law spend an inordinate amount of time reviewing, researching, meeting, reading, talking, and listening to the experts on seeds, equipment, pest control, soil, water, marketing. The list goes on and on. One thing is certain, we rely on proven science and our historical knowledge of our fields when making decisions. We also consider the future of our farm. My father-in-law has said many times that the birth of his sons changed the way he farmed. He began farming with the long-term future in mind and employed farming practices that would ensure the future for them if they chose to come back to the farm, and they both have. Our family has educational, experiential, and generational knowledge when it comes to raising crops. Our learning didn't stop with college degrees, but continues daily as the world demands more attention to conservation, environmental stewardship, food sources, and energy. And I believe that biotechnology has a place in our efforts in these areas. It has been stated now a couple different times. There's only 8 crops with commercially available GM seeds available: corn, soybeans, cotton, canola, alfalfa, sugar beets, papaya, and squash. So the majority of our consumption of these comes in the form of some very basic ingredients. And again, as has been stated, there's been numerous studies that have been conducted over the past 3 decades to ensure the safety of food that contains the ingredients from crops grown with biotechnology. GM seeds are among some of the most studied and probably the best understood plants on the planet. They've been used on farms since 1996, and as of yet, we haven't seen anything that says they are harmful. Plant biotechnology is the modern-day version of what farmers have been doing for centuries, selecting genes that make a stronger, more productive plant. And I say that having spent a day with the plant breeder from the seed corn company that we grow for, because I was curious. All this talk about this, I wanted to know, and I called them up, and they invited me in. And I was able to talk to everybody who's involved in that process. But with today's technology and knowledge, science-based knowledge of genes and DNA, plant breeders are even more precise in choosing specific traits for a crop. For us on our farm, biotechnology has allowed us to grow more plants with less soil. I say that in terms of urban sprawl and the loss of prime farmland. Less water, less nutrients, less fuel, less inputs in the form of pesticides and fertilizers. We've seen our usage cut by half. We use biotechnology as just one tool in a tool belt of many for furthering our efforts to conserve, preserve, and just raise a better crop. Farmers use many tools or modes of action to protect their crops from nutrient water-stealing weeds, insects that feast on plants, or diseases that can wipe out an acreage in a day. Pesticides, various tillage practices, analyzing weather trends or previous pressures on the field, and even the simple act of mowing the grass around the perimeter of a field will all help curb these problems. So again, I say biotechnology is just one tool that we choose to use on our farm. Labels. Today's food labels are already misunderstood. For example, organic, since that's the one we're probably almost familiar with, or maybe local or sustainable, has become synonymous with healthy. And in truth, these labels are all indicating the how of food production and are not a commentary on the health of that food. Farmers have choices in how they raise their crops, just as consumers, and I am a consumer too, have choices, many of them labeled to the point of distraction. There is no doubt that there is a place in our food system for organic foods or other foods raised in different ways. Grass-fed, corn-fed, cage-free, free-range, humanely raised, the list can go on and on and on. And there are labels that already exist indicating these available choices and provide consumers opportunities to seek out the foods that they want. So for me personally, I do oppose labeling of foods that contain ingredients derived from a plant grown from a GM seed. And I do because, as I said, labels are already misconstrued. And so adding another label focusing on biotechnology, a subject for which we've just demonstrated here today, a common definition cannot even be agreed upon, will be nothing more than another misunderstood label, doing less to inform consumers and more to confuse them. And of course, labeling involves much more than a label. It's the entire food system from, for example, my farm to the grain elevator, processors, food manufacturers, and grocers. Much like you as lawmakers have the job to be the voice of the people, I do feel comfortable speaking on behalf of fellow farmers and ranchers because I believe that we all have a choice. And regardless of how we individually choose to raise our crops or care for our animals, all of us feel an incredible sense of responsibility to our families and your families, a responsibility to do our part to secure a safe food supply, to conserve our natural resources, and respect our history, our family legacy, and our country's agricultural roots. Before I'm a farmer, I am a mother, I'm a grocery shopper, and so selfishly maybe, I do demand the best for my children. We shop at grocery stores. We make choices of the foods we eat. And as a farm mom, I am acutely aware of my place in that system. Whether it's cinnamon toast or a spaghetti dinner at night, what I hold meals that started on. Thank you again for giving me to speak on this matter.
Any questions by the committee? Thank you.
Senators, thank you so much for being here. As I introduced myself, I'm a professor at the University of Illinois, your state institution, your land-grant institution, where we cover this topic extensively in our programs. And I myself teach an undergraduate course in biotechnology and agriculture. I have been doing this since 1999. Before that, I actually was employed by the biotechnology industry, and so I've seen it from that perspective. And I bring that to my classroom. So although I'm listed in the opponent group, my job is education. So I consider my role to provide information, discuss it, and then let people come to their own conclusions. And today, you and the Illinois public are my students. So there were a number of things raised today, and there are many of them that are valid concerns. They have been for a long time since we understood that we could actually do this type of technology, which began in 1983. Starting with information, you may have this green sheet. If you don't, I hope that they will provide it to you. Listed there are 15 reasons why to label genetically engineered foods. Also, and prominently mentioned in this list, as well as in the information that was being handed out as I came in the door, was Monsanto, a company that has led the way in this technology from the very early days. They were the first to develop the technology for gene transfer, and in fact, just this year, they were awarded the World Food Prize. Rob Fraley, the chief technology officer of Monsanto, and another scientist from a university were awarded this for the impact of this discovery. So Monsanto was mentioned prominently, but to be reminded, there are many other companies that engage in this, both the development and marketing of these products. And so there should not just be one company being targeted here. And also, it may not be fair if we're dealing with a food safety issue to be targeting a seed company, because the actual labeling in that process will be carried out by the food industry, as our other panelist represents here. Okay, so going back to the 15 items on the green page here, there are three that I would say unequivocally are true. So number 7, that the American Public Health Association and the Illinois Public Health Association support labeling in this bill. And number 15. So actually there are only two here that I would say unequivocally are true, and that is that GM ingredients are in an estimated 70% of all processed foods. Other than that, every single one of these has some out of context or misinformation. I'd be happy to explain why that is. It'd be the same explanation I give in my course.
Could you provide that to the committee later on?
Absolutely, okay. Yeah. Any questions on that? Okay, so going back to, I think there were three main issues that were raised here. Food safety, number one. Second, the regulatory process. And third, the practical implications. This is essentially sort of the format of my course. I cover the science, I cover the commercialization issues, and then the societal impacts. So let me first talk about food safety, because this is foremost on people's minds. So the information, the extensive amount of information that is produced in the safety evaluation of these products can be found in two places that I will point you to. I should have put them in my notes, but I can. You can Google GM database or GM crop database, and up will come a Canadian website that for every planned or commercialized biotechnology product will contain all of the dossier documents that were used to be considered by both the United States and any other country's regulatory process that were used in the decision to allow the marketing, the importation, or the actual growing of a transgenic or GM crop. So that information is there. There are synopses of these in the Federal Register. Again, this is a public resource. You can go there and search for a specific event or company, and you would find the documents pertaining to these FDA, USDA, and EPA monitored reviews. Okay, again, to food safety. So an actuarial study. So these are life insurance companies who they would want to know if consuming GM was going to increase their outlays, so to speak, by having a shorter lifespan. So they have done a study, and their estimate is that the risk of death from eating GM is less than the risk from a supernova. Okay, specifically about one study that was raised, the Seralini et al. Study. So there are a number of things about that that have been criticized scientifically. I will just give one comment about the use of the tumor-susceptible rats that were used in the study. This is why most scientists believe that it is flawed. It would be akin to doing a study on lung cancer in habitual smokers. Okay, another aspect of the study that was brought up is that scientists are not able to do these studies independently because they can't access the seeds. So that is simply false. And then the reason I say this is, and it was mentioned that the French government is now going to sponsor a study. I was recently contacted last week by the lead scientist of that study who's asked me to grow the material, one of the locations, not the only one, but one of them, that will grow the material that will be shipped to France and used in the study. The reason they've asked me to do it is because it's not legal to grow these materials in France themselves. And we do these kind of sort of independent trials, if you will, for many organizations who want to do testing. To get access to these, it is true there are stewardship agreements. However, each one of these stewardship agreements does allow for what is called agronomic testing, which would be anything on the farm to the grain elevator, into the food system. So when they agronomic testing, that is a mandated post-market monitoring clause that the USDA requires all products to have. So if I want to access these materials, I just need to go buy them like your farm would buy them. I purchase them, I have a license to do the in a comparison of any other commercial variety that I wish, could be organic, could be anything. So there is no lack of access to the material as was presented. And in fact, I'll be doing this for the French government. Okay, another issue that Senator Kohler brought up, and it's a very important one. You mentioned this, we see a higher incidence of diseases, chronic diseases, Alzheimer's and autism were two that you mentioned. It's possible there are environmental impacts, but there's another also possibility, equally likely, that our medical advances allow us to detect and diagnose these conditions much better than before. So now we attribute a condition, say autism, whereas before we may not have actually understood what the issue was. So that isn't another possibility for the higher incidence. That is observed, that is a fact. We are detecting more of some of these diseases. Okay, moving on to the regulatory process. So I will use the analogy of aspirin, which is sort of the basis for why we have the policy in places that we do at the federal level. So aspirin, you can isolate it from tree bark. That was what we did before 1900. Then there was a chemical process. Bayer actually was that's what that company has. So aspirin, you can get it from a natural source or a chemical source, but a bottle of aspirin says aspirin. It does not distinguish from where that was processed from. And so that same logic is then used in the regulation of GM crops. It's also what would be used in any other drug that would be sold. Then going to the history, so I think Senator Brady had asked about the timing of the voluntary labeling, and so actually in the previous panel had it wrong. 1996 was not the first genetically engineered crop. It was 1992. It was the Flavor Saver tomato. It was a tomato engineered to have a slower ripening so that more sugars and flavors would be in the tomato when picked ripe, instead of harvesting them green and then having to gas them with a ripening agent later, which is actually done quite commonly now. So that product was voluntarily labeled. So there has been one that was voluntarily labeled. It was the first one, and they did this because they wanted the public to know the benefits, and in fact it was embraced, and the reason it's not on the market now was that the initial research was sponsored by Campbell's, and the goal was to put this in tomato paste and Campbell's soup, and so the varieties were geared to the canning market, not the fresh market, and when Campbell's pulled out of it, then they decided to try to market as a fresh market product, and it just wasn't, logistically, they weren't in the right situation. So, but anyhow, there was a product, 1992, that was labeled voluntarily. Then it was mentioned that the FDA revised their policies in 2001, and it was sort of presented as if this was an admission that their policies maybe weren't adequate. That would be a loose interpretation. The facts were that the initial wave of GM products, so for example, herbicide-tolerant crops, we'll say Roundup Ready soybean is one of them. There was a Roundup Ready corn. There was a Generation 1 that had been approved. Generation 2 was basically the same, but a different insertion point in the genome. And so the FDA was just clarifying that since that process had been repeated, the review needed to be repeated. It was not an admission that there was a problem. It was just a clarification because when the policy was initially written, they didn't anticipate thinking there would be second generation improvements on the original technologies. So it was a clarification, not a revision. There was a comment made about the letter that the FDA sends in consultation to the developers. And the quote that was stated is in all of these, and it essentially, in layman's terms, would be that the company is liable for any risks on the market. FDA retains the right for post-market monitoring and can recall a product if necessary, but the liability rests with the developer, not the federal government. And this was established in the U.S. Code when the policies were clarified in 1992. There is a post-market monitoring process, and we've had to use this once. In 2000 and 2001, a product was commercialized where there was some concern that the protein that was engineered may not degrade in the stomach acids immediately, like almost all proteins do. So we already have natural defense systems, as I mentioned in my written comments. Our saliva, our stomach acid, it basically obliterates DNA and protein into its component parts, and therefore is actually undetectable in our bloodstream in our bodies. This is why when animals are fed GE foods or GE feed, that the animal then is not considered GM, the animal product, because it can't be detected once it's been processed by the body. It's broken down into its component amino acids and nucleotides in the case of DNA. So the post-market monitoring that was done, this variety was sold. It was supposed to be segregated from the food supply because there were still some concerns and they wanted more testing. The companies assured that it would only be in the non-food sector, and because of a number of issues in terms of identity preservation, how difficult it is to segregate. So this will go back to Senator Frerich's question about segregation. Mistakes happened along the way. It was a learning process. So, for example, a grain elevator thought they were only receiving grain of one type. A farmer brings grain in, either knowingly or unknowingly, it's a contaminant, the wrong type. Mixing happened. That actually ended up in the export markets. Once this was recognized, the USDA and the FDA, within months, had segregated and found all of the potentially contaminating grain, and it was removed from the market. And during that time, there was a specific monitoring of food products that had been in the system. They were recalled, but some of them then were tested to see if there were any potential allergenicity issues, and none were found. So we have had one situation where we've learned that the regulatory process actually works. And because of that, the rest of the world actually looks to the United States on this topic. It is why many countries sort of accept our regulatory decisions and move forward with them on that basis. It was mentioned, a cool was mentioned as a segregation or an energy preservation system, and that certain states have adopted this. And when that has happened, it's usually been because of it enhances a specialty market in that state. The example would be California wine. If you have an identity preserved and a labeling that has value, then that would be a situation where cool would be advocated. It was also mentioned the World Trade Organization has reviewed these and actually has sort of dismissed the GM policies in the United States. That is not true, in fact. The World Trade Organization actually filed an injunction against the European Union for a moratorium on genetically engineered crops. And the World Trade Organization, after about a decade long of appeals and counter-appeals and et cetera, in 2008, after the final appeal was ruled that the EU was in fact in violation of the World Trade Organization for having a moratorium on GM. And they have since relaxed that for importation. They still do not allow those crops to be grown by farmers in the EU. Okay, practical implications then about the labeling. My last point would be there are questions about what the labels would say. So I believe Senator Holmes said, well, just say broad GM ingredients. So will it be GM corn? Will it say GM soy? Will it say, for example, in the case of corn, is it the BT gene that provides resistance to insects? Is it a herbicide tolerance gene, of which there are many? The labeling as been proposed is not specific enough, so it would not allow the consumer to actually understand what it is that they are choosing. A second issue would be, as I alluded to, the contamination issue. In that asserting that a product is GE-free requires testing, and that testing is difficult for the reasons I said earlier. DNA, protein are rapidly processed, difficult to detect in their native form, in the form that we would consider them as a functional entity that could cause an allergenicity or toxicity problem. The costs for identity preservation, there are a number of examples. The University of Illinois has done studies on this. In my former employment in the seed industry, we did studies on if we had a product that was nutritionally enhanced, how would we keep that in the marketplace as such? And so the example was what is called high oil corn or high lysine corn. These were seed varieties engineered to be nutritionally enhanced for animal feed. And so the cost that we determined, this was in conjunction with Cargill, who is one of the largest grain handlers in the United States and worldwide, and independent study done by the University of Illinois in the early 2000s estimated 50 cents a bushel for corn and 25 cents a bushel for soybean to keep an identity preserved system. And where this then happens, it happens, for example, in most of the corn that ends up in your tortilla chips, your taco shells, is what's called food grade white corn. It is identity preserved. Farmers are paid a premium to grow that and keep that separate from other corn. And they get more for their corn than if they just grew regular commodity corn. That system exists. It could be, created in another situation, but the cost would, there's a pretty clear idea what those would be. There's also then the issue of testing. Who tests? Who is liable when, an example for, if, you know, for the Starlink situation, a farmer brings a load into the grain elevator and lies to the grain elevator that it's not what it's supposed to be. Who then is liable if that makes it into the food chain when these things could happen? So who does the testing? It would have to be tested at many different, basically anywhere where the baton would be handed, a transfer of that commodity anywhere along the production chain would need to be documented. Again, it can happen, but we already know what the costs are because they're existing systems. I think with that, I will close and happy to take any questions on this or anything else that was covered today.
Yes, thank you. I've got a couple questions. Why do you think there's such a disconnect between what I hear consumers talking about and what the industry is promoting?
Which industry?
Well, just in terms of the genetically engineered industry, I mean, there seems to be, I guess, either a lack of objective scientific research that that can prove or give us some reasonable assurance of what the food safety or the quality of the product is. I mean, is that why we're here? I mean, because we have this divide that we're trying to somehow connect?
I think it comes to education. As I said, these documents exist. They are lengthy, and they are written for scientists so that other scientists can read them and say, yes, they did the study correctly. I have confidence in the results. And I can make an assessment that can never say there will be no risk. That's the precautionary principle, which is what the WTO actually ruled was illegal.
And here's a question for either you or David. Is the move towards genetically engineering food products, what is the driving force? Is it food safety and nutrition, or is it cost or convenience, or what is it? What is the driving force behind going to genetically engineered foods?
I'll follow.
Well, you have to speak, yield to this gentleman, but originally, and this is what's kind of interesting about today's situation, is originally there were scientists, a lot of them from St. Louis area, Monsanto, as well as university people, who were really bothered by the amount of chemicals that were being put into the water table. And this was in the late 70s, and they said, geez, I wonder if we could use some refinement of the techniques that humans have used for thousands of years to reduce the amount of chemicals that are being put into our water tables. And so they were actually hanging out together in South San Francisco with the founders of Genentech, who were doing the same kind of thing with medicines. And these are the two gentlemen, especially Roger Beachy, I think was the guy you were alluding to. And so that was the original precipitating thing, was these guys were kind of had an environmental bent, and one guy really wanted to turn Monsanto, which at the time was a chemical company, into a biotech company for that reason. So they were very shocked when post-mad cow disease, the stuff was rejected in Europe. They said, you know, the environmentalists, and we said, well, we're the greenies. So a lot of the early impetus, once they got going, was focused on agronomic benefits for the farmer. For some of the things I mentioned, less soil runoff, less pesticide, less fossil fuel use, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And Parlberg argues that one of the reasons that that it hasn't been greater accepted by consumers is it's really a businessman's benefit. I mean, farmers are phenomenal business people, highly technical. It's one of the most techie businesses you can possibly be in. And a lot of the benefits went to the benefit of the farmer, who had to spend less on pesticide, herbicide, running the tractor back and forth across the field, losing less of the soil value over time, and then facing harassment because of a runoff of all this stuff into our water table. As time's gone by, it's been seized more and more to cope with climate change and to address the concerns of the folks who still remain either in a state of dire poverty, which is the case that Parlberg focuses most on his book Starve for Science and how this stuff is being kept out of Africa, or specific nutritional deficits, which is this golden rice situation. And that's not driven by any one company. It's done by a consortium of companies. Nobody will profit unduly if that succeeds. Mm-hmm. But there's a need to get beta-carotene into the diet of people who are afflicted in the regions I mentioned with a tremendous lack. So I'd say originally it was environmental. It kind of moved to environmental and agronomic, and now it's moving increasingly to nutrition and food security.
But what you said was that somehow the consumers haven't been made a part of that conversation.
I'd say that's a fair statement, and there was recently, I forget the name of the website that just opened up, that anybody that has a question about any of this stuff...
See, that's a problem, isn't it?
Well, I agree.
Because
it reminds me
of... Who is it that pays for all this stuff?
All of us.
Well, it's a consumer. I mean, we're the end users of it.
Right.
Don't need any help, please.
No, I share your frustration.
Here's the point, and I understand. I mean, if you're talking about ways of trying to keep farmers from having to use the chemicals that they do. I mean, those are all things that that we can support. It's just that how do we have this conversation together so that we're both, you know, kind of operating out of the same basis of information and we have the same belief system. I'll tell you, as a consumer, where my experience makes me cautious. I had some shoulder problems years ago, and so I went to the doctor, and the thing that they always prescribed for me was Vioxx. And I would get a prescription every time I went. Now, I never took it because I didn't want to take that stuff. And all of a sudden, they took it off the market. And it's like, I wish I would have saved all those scripts, because it made a more effective story. But that's why, as a consumer, my faith gets a little bit shaken. And so I don't disagree with anything you've said, David, in terms of, or Professor Moose, what you've said about, you know, the attempts of the industry. We're all trying to create a better world. I understand that. But if we don't have this conversation together, and if we don't believe one another, then there's a big problem. And that's what part of this hearing was trying to do, is this: let's bring this information out. Let's see where we can cooperate, because what I've, you know, been led to believe, and it goes on both sides. On one hand, people say, well, the only reason Monsanto is doing this is because they can sell Roundup to farmers. Well, I'm not sure that's the case. I mean, but, you know, I understand the profit motive, and I understand the need to have you know, copyrighted products and all that. We're not trying to change the free market system here, but we're just trying to somehow come together on this thing so we have some confidence.
I think you've put your finger on something, and that is that we can't really escape individual responsibility. I mean, when I was rushing through the grocery store one day, you know, I said, God, man, I've been eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for the last 6 days. I got to get some soup for lunch. So I ran through, and I thought, the problem with soup commercially is they put too much salt in it. So I said, I know what I'll do. I just ran through the organic aisle, and I grabbed a couple organic soups. So I took them to work, and I'm starting to eat the soup. I'm like, man, this tastes awfully salty. And I went and dug out of the garbage, you know, the can. I looked at it, and eating that can of organic soup would have been 78% of the amount of salt I'm allowed to eat in a day, and most scientists think that's too high. We can't take away individual responsibility.
Yeah. Thank goodness it was on the label.
Yeah. I read the label.
I understand.
I read the label.
Point,
I read the label and determined that that organic product wasn't too safe.
Well, I understand, but again, you had the information and you could make the decision on that. All I'm saying is that I think we've had this is the last of our hearings. I think we've had a good conversation. I'm concerned that we still have this big chasm between us, and I think that there's a lot of common ground that we actually share in this issue, and we need to continue that conversation so we can get to the same place of supporting, you know, folks in your industry that want to do the right thing, but letting us have the confidence that it is the right thing. That's all I'm saying. Is there other questions? Senator Holmes.
I just want to bring something up because I think a couple of people have brought this up a number of times, and to be honest, I've done a lot of town hall meetings on autism, and I think it sort of highlights one of the things we're talking about here, and it's that there seem to be so many conflicting studies, because the one thing I can tell you with autism, as I have continued to have my roundtables and the number of people who are diagnosed with autism, is that there was a time when parents quit giving their children vaccinations because they thought autism was caused by the thermosol in vaccinations. And this, because again, you had conflicting studies, what you ended up having were parents that refused to do this vaccination, potentially allowing their children to be exposed to crippling or potentially fatal diseases. It later then came out that no, it's not the thermostat in vaccinations. I'm saying, so we're looking at conflicting data, and I don't think we should jump to conclusions and absolutely change our way of life until we get more facts. So that's why I would like to say in this case, I think we've got a lot of work to do before we go and we actually advocate for we absolutely must label everything right now.
Let me just take back control of the meeting here, please. We are being kicked out of the room. I'm sorry. We've come to the end of our 2 hours. I want to thank the panel. What we will do with the subcommittee is we will regroup when we get back to veto session and kind of see where we want to go. But I agree that there's more work to do. I'm going to adjourn this meeting and thank all of the panelists for your participation and the audience for coming.